السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته الحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وبعد. Today it's Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala as he tells us in Surah Al-A'raf verse 31 يَا بَنِي آدَمْ خُذُوا زِينَتَكُمْ عِنْدَ كُلِّ مَسْجِدٍ وَكُلُوا وَشْرَبُوا وَلَا تُسْرِفُوا إِنَّهُ لَا يُحِبُّ الْمُسْرِفِينَ. This is a verse that encourages us to be balanced. But at the same time, when we're talking about being balanced, enjoy yourself, have fun, eat, drink, just, you know, have fun in your life, but don't overindulge yourself. So let's break this down step by step. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is not talking to just Muslims. Ya bani Adam, O children of Adam, خُذُوا زِينَتَكُمْ عِنْدَ كُلِّ مَسْجِدٍ. So the first command is to take your beauty, take your zina, take your beauty, take your adornment. Make yourself beautiful. So in other words, wear your best clothing, put on some perfume, put on some cologne, whatever you want. But especially when you're going to the masjid, look appropriate. And this is really important because pretty much every masjid you go to, wherever you are, there's always that group of Muslims that will come to the masjid. And they'll come from work, the guys just finished painting an entire house, the kids them just finished playing sports, and they'll jump right into the salah. You know, that's all fine. But at the end of the day, this is not the proper etiquette in the sight of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, especially when you're praying, but especially when you're walking into His house. I mean, if you look at it from a logical perspective, would you walk into a guest's house wearing sweaty clothing or your dirtiest attire? You wouldn't do that. At least you would consider, okay, these are guests, I want to look appropriate, you'll have an extra pair of clothing or something, change into, and then there you are. Why not the same for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's house? I mean, it's reached to such an extent that scholars had to come up with specified fiqh rulings of what to do when you're praying beside somebody or you're with somebody in the masjid, and whatever it could be, you know, whether it's just a bad smell, bad hygiene in general, or even their clothing is so dirty to the extent that now people started asking, am I allowed to pray beside somebody like that? It's too distracting for me. The sweat and the smell is overbearing. Can I leave my salah? And Ibn al-Qayyim rahimahullah has a ruling. Imam al-Shafi'i, all the madhahibs have a ruling on this. And it's just like, it really makes you think, subhanAllah, that scholars had to study this mas'ala, this scenario, and come up with a ruling they felt was appropriate, that if you were in that scenario, that somebody who wasn't dressed well or the odor was so overwhelming, that you had to decide for the sake of concentration in your worship whether you need to be there beside your brother or sister or step out of the prayer, step out of the halaqah, step out of the talk, whatever the case is, and go somewhere else and sit somewhere else or stand somewhere else. And subhanAllah, this is just really unfortunate. This is a requirement as people of Iman, that especially when you go to the masjid, that you look decent, you smell decent, you have overall good hygiene. And our Prophet ﷺ did teach us that half of our faith, half of our Iman, shatrul Iman, half of it is based on tahur. It's based on purity, it's based on cleanliness. That means that if you dress well, you smell good, you take care of yourself, you don't just pull out the oldest clothing that you can find, you pull out the most wrinkled abaya, the most wrinkled hijab, you pull out the thawb or the pants and the shirt that you wear when you're outside doing gardening or something, and that's the stuff that you wear at the masjid. And especially for the young students as well, if you go to the masjid to play sports, that's all great, alhamdulillah, but just make sure that all that sweaty clothing when you're in your athletic wear, that at least you either cover that up with something more decent or just change when it comes time for prayer, but especially overall when you're in Allah's house. There's a certain level of etiquettes and mannerisms that is from our sunnah. You know, the companions they had described that the Prophet ﷺ always smelled beautiful. He smelled so beautiful to the point where even his perspiration they described, it was sweeter than the scent of the sweetest musk perfume you could find. And the Prophet ﷺ loved to wear beautiful clothing. although he was limited to what he had, if he had white clothing, it was beautiful, it was clean, it smelled good. He loved to perfume himself. He loved to ensure that, and this is why the Prophet ﷺ did tell us that إِنَّ اللَّهَ جَمِيلٌ وَيُحِبُّ الْجَمَالِ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is beautiful, and he loves that which is beautiful. So exactly, combing your hair or putting on your hat, making sure your clothing is ironed, all of these things are part of this ayah. It's a part of our faith to be this way. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us, take that beauty that I've blessed you with, especially when you go عند كل مسجد, in all the masajid. So it doesn't matter if it's your own local masjid, at least look decent when you go there. Because a lot of Muslims will say, oh, it's just my own masjid, I just go in there in my pajamas and I'm good, everybody knows me. That's not the point here. So fulfill the ayah. It's about looking representable and decent in the sight of Allah. What we also learn from this ayah is that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does pay attention to the outerwear. He may not judge, or the judgment itself is not restricted to just what's on the outside, because obviously what's in your heart, your intentions, your sincerity, these are important factors as well. But it's not to just exclude or completely disregard what you are on the outside, because that's how you and I judge each other. You can judge me, I judge you based on our outer shell. So if our outer shell is clean, it's decent, it's representable, then inshallah ta'ala, that's a reflection of what's inside of us, what's in our hearts, what's in our intentions. Next point with it is that, keep in mind, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala singles out masjids. So the ayah doesn't say, خُذُوا زِينَتُكُمْ عِنْدَ كُلِّ أَسْوَاقٍ. You know, take your beauty to every mall or shopping center that you go to. No, it's specifically talking about the masjid. So this teaches us that this is a priority in the sight of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that particularly when it comes to His house and place of worship, this is an expectation of all of us. Then the ayah continues, وَكُلُوا وَشْرَبُوا وَلَا تُسْرِفُوا. Eat and drink, but don't be excessive. Don't indulge yourself in this. You know, we can talk about eating and drinking. I think that's pretty obvious that at the end of the day, you want to ensure that whatever it is that you choose to consume, that of course it meets all the requirements Islamically. It's halal, it's been earned in the halal will, etc. But also that you just don't overdo it. Like you spend $15 on a bottle of water. Israf literally means that you can afford the same thing at a cheaper price elsewhere. Once in a while, when you want to take the family out to a nice dinner or what have you, spend a little extra money, once in a while, and this is the balance that we're talking about, once in a while doing those things is completely fine. Our Prophet ﷺ, although he had just a few pieces of clothing, whenever he was gifted, like he was gifted a cloak from someone from Yemen, he was gifted a cloak from people from all across the Arabian Peninsula, he was given different gifts to wear, and he would wear them. He wouldn't say, oh, you know, I don't want that, that's too beautiful, that looks too expensive. No, these were expensive cloaks that came, expensive garments that came from representatives across the Arabian Peninsula, and they would gift this to him, and he wouldn't say, no, I don't want that, I'm not into that sort of thing, that's just for the rich. He actually took it, and he wore it. So once in a while, to be able to go to the mall, to do some shopping, do whatever you like, that's completely fine. You know, every so often I meet a family or a parent that will say, you know, I never take my kids to the mall. You know, I don't have no TV in my house. We don't have no video games, nothing. But once in a while, when I do open that door for them, like on just before Eid, I like to go shopping. But then I find myself that when I go shopping that one or two days, I indulge myself. I go to every store, I buy something from every store I can go to, even if I don't need it. I let my kids have their video games once a month, and when they sit there, they'll sit there for 5 hours and play the same thing over and over. What do I do? And really my answer is very simple. Ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to protect you from being extreme, because that's not right. It's not right to just be on one side of the coin and ignore everything else. The Prophet ﷺ enjoyed himself. He enjoyed certain delights whenever he had access to them. He enjoyed eating and drinking and socializing. He had time for those things. And there are so many narrations of him just sitting with his wife Aisha رضي الله عنها in the masjid. And you know what they're doing? They're just talking. He's not teaching her. He's not quoting to her all these hadith. No, they're just talking. There are hadith of her just sitting there, and she'll talk to him about all the women that she met that day and the kinds of conversations that they had and what they were talking about. And then the Prophet ﷺ, there are other stories of him with a bunch of companions. They're sitting together. They're wrestling. They're racing. They're playing. They're laughing. So much so, some companions describe, we could see his molar teeth when he would laugh. I don't even know how to laugh that much where you can see my molar teeth. But the Prophet ﷺ would do that. So you could definitely see that he had this balanced side to his personality, to his life. So when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, kulu and washrabu, eat and drink, remember, this ayah is saying that you can do those things, but it's now going to limit it by saying, look how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala balances all of these wonderful things. So we talked about dressing and appearance, particularly in Allah's house. And then we talked about eating and drinking. These are the two most important things when it comes to social gatherings. It's people look good, they're having a fun time, and there's always something good to eat and drink. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَكُلُوا وَشَرْبُوا وَلَا تُسْرِفُوا, and don't overindulge. You know, there are some people, when they meet up with their friends, their only conversations that go on literally for hours, especially with young people, but even, you know, adults in general, we're all guilty of doing this, right? I'm not saying I'm perfect either. From time to time, I end up doing the same thing, where your only conversation is revolved around entertainment, sports, you know, social media, friends. It's just a very specific area where there's no benefit to it whatsoever. As a matter of fact, it might even incline somebody to sin. You might hear something you're not supposed to hear. It might stimulate a conversation you shouldn't be having. You might say certain things you know they're haram to say. You might look at certain things you know you shouldn't be there. And so those kinds of conversations, this is the only type of conversation for some groups of people. So this is what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying. That's a problem. If every time you meet up with your friends and you have these specific types of conversations that put you in a problem or get you involved in things you shouldn't be involved in, that's a problem in and of itself. And so Allah says, وَلَا تُسْرِفُوا إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يُحِبُّ الْمُسْرِفِينَ. And also Allah says, إِنَّهُ لَا يُحِبُّ الْمُسْرِفِينَ in other verses of the Quran. The point is, Allah says, I do not appreciate, I do not love the ones who overindulge themselves. Israf, when you concentrate too much on one thing and ignore everything else. What Islamically is that you give haqq and time for everything in your life and not all of your concentration just on one thing. And even when we're learning, the scholars teach us, أَنْتَ تَعَلَّمَ شَيْئًا فِي كُلِّ شَيْءٍ, that you understand a little bit of everything, and not kullu shay'in an shay'in, and not just everything just on one thing. So you know a little bit of just general things to do. You know how to do certain chores. You know how to do certain duties. You know how to, you know, understand a little bit about, you know, why the sky is blue, how to change a light bulb, how to fix something. But at the same time, you're also engrossed into your Islamic knowledge, your secular knowledge, and other things as well. So it's all about being balanced. Now, the billion-dollar question, which I'm going to conclude with, is how do you develop that? The answer really varies. Usually, your upbringing, your surroundings, the people that you have, the level of exposure that you have, also your level of knowledge, how you learn knowledge. One day, we're going to talk about, and I'll give you certain methods, inshallah, that could really help balance your approach in how to learn ilm. Because often what ends up happening is you have somebody who's learning knowledge will fall into an ultra-conservative mentality where everything is haram. And then you'll have the complete opposite, this ultra-liberal mentality where all is good as long as you have a good heart. So one day we're going to talk about how to balance those two approaches, because you need a little bit of both, but what's in the middle is what counts the most. But at least for now, my brothers and sisters, this ayah, as well as many other verses of the Quran, call us to be balanced in our leisure time. Be balanced in the sense that have fun, enjoy your delights, enjoy your family, enjoy your friends, enjoy social time, have all of those things. They're important because that's what keeps you balanced. So one method that immediately this ayah is teaching us is, yeah, when you are doing all of those wonderful things of learning and worship and so on, there it's also just as important to have downtime. But too much of even a halal thing is problematic. You know, if you sit there and you're watching TV for 7 hours a day, every single day, although TV, generally speaking, is perfectly halal, the haram of it is haram, but the halal of it is halal. So you're sitting there and you're watching TV, or you're scrolling through the internet, you're binging videos, etc., etc. All of this is a problem. This is what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying. Don't overindulge yourself in this stuff, whether it be in eating, drinking. You know, some families I meet, every other day they have to like hit up a new restaurant. I know some people who even like get in their cars and they drive for like 2-3 hours just to go have like lobster or something, or just have one meal somewhere else. You know, that's fine if it's like a once in a lifetime thing, by all means. But other than that, I hope that by now, insha'Allah ta'ala, you understand the balance concept in this ayah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala encourages all of us, commands all of us, especially when we're in His house, to ensure that we look best, that we represent ourselves the best way that we can, in whatever limited capacity that we have, that we at least have good hygiene, especially when we are praying and standing in front of Him subhanahu wa ta'ala, but to also balance that with enjoyment of food, drink, some leisure time, but of course, don't overindulge. That's the key lesson in this ayah. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala continue to teach us His beautiful book. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala continue to preserve and protect the love of the legacy of our Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in our hearts and in our lives. Allahumma ameen. Jazakumullahu khairan, everybody. Till we meet again. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.